First, some, well, refreshing your knowledge about fission physics, because this is stuff you've probably learned at some stage, but it's maybe not the topic you are actively thinking about every day. So let's revisit the very simple things about fission physics. Uranium, as we find it in nature, has two isotopes, uranium-235, uranium-238. And in physics, in fission, what matters is the interaction of these isotopes with neutrons. If a neutron interacts with uranium-235, you get fission. The nucleus falls apart in lighter nuclei, plus the generation of heat. That's what you are interested in, that's what you want to harvest, plus 2 to 3 secondary neutrons. Now, what happens to these secondary neutrons? Either they interact with uranium-238, and then that's it, nothing happens any further. Or they escape into the environment, nothing happens any further too. Or they interact with another uranium-235 isotope, and then you get again fission. And now the trick is, try to let these new neutrons interact with ever more uranium-235, and you get a chain reaction, and that's how you can collect the energy. Now, in natural uranium, your content of uranium-235 is just 0.7%. That's not enough to sustain such a chain reaction. You will have just individual fission events. If you isotopically enrich uranium to have more uranium-235, in the very extreme case, when you enrich up to 90% and more, then there is no way to stop this chain reaction anymore. You get an exponential increase of fission events, a lot of energy, so you have created a nuclear weapon. The interesting range is in between, when you have for an electricity generation, a power reactor, 4 to 5% of uranium-235. That's a regime where you can sustain a chain reaction, but you still have enough tools to moderate the chain reaction such that it doesn't run out of control. That happens in a typical fission reactor for electricity generation. We all know the problems with generating electricity in that way. Two main problems. There can be an accident with your reactor, think Fukushima, or even if there is no accident, such a reactor produces a decent amount of long-living radioactive waste that you have to store somewhere for the next half a million of years. These are two disadvantages of that type of electricity generation. And that's why, in order to cure these two disadvantages, that there is research going on what would be a better type of nuclear reactor to avoid these two disadvantages. An example of such research is the MIRA reactor, which is going to be built by the Belgian Nuclear Research Center. And that is a so-called accelerator-driven system. It uses the same fuel, the same uranium, as a conventional fission reactor, but it's subcritical. There is not enough uranium-235 to sustain the chain reaction. Now, where do you get then enough neutrons to keep this reaction going? These neutrons come from outside. The system is coupled to a linear accelerator that accelerates a powerful proton beam, and that proton beam interacts with the coolant of this reactor. So this is not a water-cooled reactor, it's a reactor cooled by a liquid metal, a mixture of lead and bismuth at a temperature of a few hundred degrees Kelvin. So it's a liquid metal, and that absorbs the excess heat that comes from the nuclear reactions, from the fissions. Now, this proton beam interacts with that liquid metal, and that induces a few nuclear reactions that result into extra neutrons. And these neutrons are then sufficient to sustain your chain reaction. If a problem happens, an earthquake or an airplane that crashes on your reactor building, well, then this accelerator will probably stop working, and then everything stops. So such a reactor can never run out of control. That's the advantage of an accelerator-driven system. The other advantage, which becomes relevant even if you are never going to produce electricity with such a reactor, because maybe in 50 years from now, solar and wind energy will be sufficiently abundant and cheap in order not to need any more efficient reactor. Well, even then, this machine is relevant because it can be used as a transmutator. You can put in the reactor core not only the uranium fuel, but also this long-living radioactive waste from the conventional fission reactors. And the high neutron fluxes that are present in this machine can induce nuclear reactions into this radioactive waste to transform it into short-living waste. So it's a way to get rid of the heritage of nuclear waste from the conventional fission reactors. Furthermore, the machine is built in such a way that it also can produce new types of medical isotopes. So enough reasons to go for building this machine and building up experience in the engineering of such accelerator-driven systems. That doesn't mean that there aren't any disadvantages, and one of the manageable disadvantages, but still a disadvantage, is that in this lead bismuth liquid metal coolant, there are nuclear reactions happening that result into 210 polonium, which is a highly radiotoxic isotope. The dose you can ingest before dying is in the nanogram region. So it's really something you don't want to have in the environment. Now, it's nicely contained within this liquid metal. It cannot do any harm there. But it could happen that some of these isotopes would diffuse into the cover gas that is on top of this liquid metal. And then you have to be careful, because if you open the reactor for maintenance, it could escape into the environment. So you have to know what happens to this polonium-210 in gas conditions. If you know that, you can design a suitable filter system, and then the problem is contained. Now, you can examine then the chemistry of polonium in the conditions that are relevant for the cover gas. But then you run into problems that in order to do measurements on the amount of polonium you need to use the conventional measurements techniques, well, that's just too much polonium-210 to handle safely in a lab. Very few labs in the world are licensed to work with these amounts of polonium-210. So that's an example of what I said a few minutes ago. It's too dangerous to do these experiments. Eventually, you will have to do a few of such experiments, but the less the better. So it would be a sound alternative to go in the computational way and don't do the experiments, but compute first what will likely happen to your polonium, and then you are better prepared to do the experiments. You will need less experiments in the end than if you wouldn't know anything in advance. So that's our motivation, to study the chemistry of polonium in this kind of environments. How could you tackle such a problem? Well, it's no need to be very original. The standard thing you want to know is the heat of formation of a molecule that contains polonium. I take in the example there a diatomic molecule, lead, polonium. You want to know its formation energy. And you want to know this as a function of temperature. That formation energy is the energy difference between, at one hand, the Gibbs-free energy at that temperature of the diatomic molecule minus the Gibbs-free energies of the two individual atoms. That's what you want to calculate. We will do this not only for lead polonite, but for a series of 6 diatomic molecules. Each of them are molecules that you could argue can exist in the environment of the lead bismuth liquid metal with perhaps some water contamination. That's why polonium hydride and polonium oxide appears. And we also add lithium polonium because, well, that is not something that will happen in the MIRA reactor, but the same problem is present in fusion reactors with a lithium lead breeder blanket. So that's an environment where you have lithium available, so it makes sense to add also lithium to this story. So for these 6 molecules, at the moment we deliberately limit ourselves to only diatomic molecules, for these 6 diatomic molecules we are going to calculate the formation energy. Formation energy, that means the sum of this internal energy, the PV term and the entropy term. And both the entropy term and the energy term can be divided in a kinetic contribution and an external internal contribution. So we have to calculate all these properties. Let's be pragmatic. We take the reasonable assumption that this gas of atoms and light molecules at high temperatures, we are talking 600 degrees Kelvin here, will likely behave more or less like an ideal gas. So we will consider where we can this to be an ideal gas. And what are the consequences of that assumption? The PV term, if you express your Gibbs free energy per molecule or per atom, the PV term will reduce to kBT. The translation energy term will be 1.5 RT. The entropy term, Sacur tetrode, you know the expression from thermodynamics. So these are quantities we can readily fill out. Then the internal contributions. Well, this boils down to knowing the energy level scheme of the object. Once you know the energy level scheme, you can calculate with your thermodynamical recipes the partition function. And once you know the partition function, the associated entropy is readily found. So we need to know the energy level scheme for the free atoms that are involved and for the diatomic molecules that are involved. Let's start with the free atoms. Well, that's actually an easy job because this is experimentally known. The energy level scheme of even the free polonium atom is known. And I take these data just from the NIST database with all energy levels of all atoms and ions. So you see the lowest 4 energy levels here. The scale goes up to 2.7 eV. And here you apply your usual thermodynamics. So I can calculate the partition function. You see the expression there. And in the case of this energy level scheme with the first excited state almost 1 eV above the ground state, this reduces to basically just one term that involves the ground state energy. The consequence of that is that the associated entropy, the electron contribution, the internal contribution to the entropy for the free atoms is 0. You can calculate other things. The occupation of these levels at our example temperature of 600 Kelvin. If you fill out the numbers and use the familiar expressions from thermodynamics, you find that really almost everything is in the lowest level. You are not exciting your polonium atoms. So for the free atom, we can fill out the entire table. The Gibbs free energy as a function of temperature for the free atom is known. What to do about the diatomic molecule? There is no NIST database for diatomic molecule energy levels, and the experiments are, for the reasons that I mentioned, very hard to do. So this is something you want to calculate, and you are not going to use DFT for that, because DFT for a highly correlated diatomic molecule is probably not going to give you values that are too reliable, that are too close to the experimental values. This is a problem for quantum chemistry. We are not quantum chemists in our group. We have a background in solid-state DFT. So we teamed up with Ivan Infante from the Free University of Amsterdam in the Netherlands, who has the suitable background on this. And he taught us how to use post-Hartree-Fock methods that are suitable for this problem. So I list here the three levels of theory that were tested, CAS-SEF, CAS-PT2, and SO-CASI, spin-orbit coupling with complete active space self-interaction. We tested all three of them. It turns out that the CAS-PT2 level is almost sufficiently reliable, but it was computationally possible to go one step further. So all results you will see are at this highest level of post-Hartree-Fock methods, which will be totally sufficient to give values that are even within the experimental error bars. So we apply this to, for instance, the lead-polonium molecule. And we calculate total energy versus the internuclear distance. And the results are curves like this. The lowest energy you can reach, that's the ground state of the molecule. But we also calculate the first few excited states. And what you see there are all excited states that have a minimum that lies below the 2 electron volt that corresponds to the dissociation energy from the ground state. So these are all the relevant levels. Up to here, that's exactly the same story as for the free atom. But the molecule is a little bit more complicated because, contrary to the free atom, the molecule can vibrate. So you have to take into account the vibrational energy levels, which, if you look at that same scale, are much closer together in energy. And if we use the same recipe to calculate the occupation of all these vibrational levels, you see that up to 10 vibrational levels are occupied. Additionally, the molecule can also rotate, and these levels are even closer together. There are 75 of such levels between the first vibrational levels. So it's a much denser energy level scheme. But once you have it, you can apply the same recipes as before. Now, how do we get these rotational vibrational levels in a straightforward way? That problem was solved already long ago. So this is a paper from January 1941, Journal of Chemical Physics, where people have proposed an equation of state of 5 simple variables. If you fit your energy versus internuclear distance to that equation of state, you can extract these 5 variables, and these are everything you need to write explicit expressions for all these rotational vibrational levels. So straight from our quantum chemistry results, E versus R, make these fits for the ground state and the excited states, and you find all the rotational vibrational levels out of this. And once you have that, you apply partition function, you get the entropy contribution. So that we did for this list of 6 molecules, and the result is this delta G, the formation energy as a function of temperature for these 6 molecules. That probably doesn't tell you very much to see all these results just in that graph, but I will show how you can use this now. But let me first try to give you some confidence that these results are really reliable, and that I can do by looking at the formation energy at 0 Kelvin, which is for 1 of these molecules experimentally known. Dipolonium has been studied in, was it 1957, at a time when safety restrictions still did allow to do such experiments in a lab. And there they found experimentally 1.9 EV as binding energy for this molecule. We get these binding energies at low temperature directly from our quantum chemistry calculations, and that's the table at the right-hand side. And you see that we can nicely come close to this dipolonium value, and you get also values for all the other molecules. By applying these recipes to lighter elements, where you do know the experimental values, we can put an error bar on our results, so we can be confident that within about 0.05 electron volts, these numbers are in agreement with experiments. And that's at the same order of magnitude as the experimental error bars you could expect. So here, these calculations are as good as experiments and much safer. So how can you use this now? Now it's actually simple. You put all these elements and molecules together in one imaginary box at the concentrations in which you expect them in the reactor, in this case the cover gas of Mira, and you search for the minimal value of this total Gibbs-free energy, and you extract from this the relative occurrence of the different molecules with polonium. And if you do this for actual Mira conditions, you find that the most dominant molecule is this lead polonium, followed by atomic polonium. This is a logarithmic scale, so the next one, bismuth polonium, is already negligible. If you apply the same to a fusion reactor situation, then it's the same lead polonium, atomic polonium, and then lithium polonium as the next one. So this is an example where you can directly go from quantum physics information to engineering information that is relevant for constructing such a big device. I should certainly mention here the PhD student who did all this work, Merlijn Mertens. He is the one who knit all these lines of thinking together and did the many calculations, the careful analysis to come to these results.
Thank you very much.